Hey, Bob Hughes, JD Squared. I want to give you a quick update what we're doing here right now. And the reason I am is we have one customer who already has the machine, and he bought it to cut this 12-inch channel. And he makes spiral staircases. The company's called Casco. I've seen the pictures of what they do. It's truly amazing. So if you're looking for staircases, stuff like that, check out Casco. Well, they have an RC6, and this was the piece of 12-inch channel that they brought with them. So I made a couple changes to the machine. I had another customer who's ordered the RC6, and he wants to know, how do we mount flat stock into the RC6? And then we have a couple other things we've been working on. For instance, we're very close to wood routers now, releasing the wood router. I'll show you that in a second. So I thought, what the hey, let's go ahead and shoot a quick video, and I'll kind of like give these people an update of what we're doing, and you can kind of get a feel also what we're doing. Anyway, what we have here, let's start off with the RC6. We have the 12-inch channel in place. So for the gentleman who ordered the machine, was wondering how we mounted flats, the machines come with these flat plate adapters right here. It'll come with two of them, and it has a back fence, which you can't really see because the channel is hiding it. You can see it in other videos that I've previously done. But anyway, to answer your question, Eugene, this is how we would mount flat stock on the machine. Now, let's talk about what happened with Casco. They came in and they knew that the plasma cutter couldn't cut through the web because this is an RC6, which means it's designed to handle up to 6-inch square. It'll handle bigger round, but only 6-inch square. So we cannot rotate a 12-inch piece of channel in this machine. Hopefully later this year we'll have the RC12 and it will be easily able to handle that. But right now they needed something, let's get going. So they got the RC6. Now what happened was when it cut, and I'll take a picture, put it in a little corner so you can see it. They cut in from the edge, cut across, everything worked beautiful. However, obviously on the flanges, the plasma cutter can't cut through 3 inches, you know? So what I've done here, the other problem we ran into too, wasn't really a problem. It wasn't a problem for them, but I could see where it'd be in the future. The torch is normally mounted right here on the front. You can see it in previous videos. Well, we lose that distance from the torch to the scriber. So they didn't have a problem because they were scribing squares, diagonal squares right here. And once again, look at the close-up picture. And this is where evidently they're going to place whatever it is they're placing there. And this is where they want the welders to weld it. Well, it turned out that with the torch up here, we had a dead zone of about 2.5 inches on the outside. Didn't affect what they want to do, but it got me thinking. Supposing you did want complete coverage of your 12-inch plate, scriber, marker, and torch. So what I went ahead and did, and I went ahead and sent them a free one, I made this bracket right here that bolts onto the side. It's on there right now, and it bolts on where our router bolts, and it allows us to place the torch right here. It still has the breakaway and everything on it. Worked out real good. And I basically lined up the torch with the scribers so that now we have full travel of the scribers and the torch over the entire length. And I thought, okay, that'll work out pretty well for them. What else can I do to make their life easier? And what it is we want to be able to cut through this flange, because right now when the plasma cut it, it gouged it, of course, and all they're going to do is they're going to put a ruler on it and they're going to plasma cut it and away they go. They're happy, they're fine. I want to raise the game. I want to make their life as easy as possible. So what I've gone ahead and started doing is I finally picked up a torch, a short body torch. This thing's hard to find. I got with Victor. Lead times are pretty much the end of the year, 4 to 5 months, the best I could tell. So I found this Chinese copy on, I believe, Amazon, and lo and behold, it looks pretty doggone good. I mean, it looks really nice. So what you're gonna be seeing me do here in the very near future, and this is going out to Casco and all, is we're gonna be mounting this torch out here as soon as we get the valves in. You've probably seen us cut heavy plate. We cut 3.5-inch plate daily on our MAD cutters, our PVC cutters and all, our PVD cutter. So this machine, same setup, it'll cut it easily. And what my thinking is with this torch here, I'm gonna be able to start on the edge out here. And as long as I use a sufficiently large nozzle that'll cut through 3-inch, I'm going to be able to strike it, cut through the flange, it'll transition into the thinner section of the channel, no big deal. So what? We got a little bit bigger tip than we need. That's not going to be a problem at all. We go ahead, we cut, bam-o, Casco's got their entire step in one operation. So that's what I'm doing for them. Now, another thing we're going to be doing with this here is we'll be mounting it on the machine, and we're going to go ahead and start working in Camelot a generating code that will tilt the torch. And the reason I want to use a fuel gas torch is because with plasma, when you tilt them over, the arc tries to bend down towards the plate, and you can't get the angle that you think. Whereas with a torch, shoot, we don't care. We'll cut a 45, 50-degree angle, no problem. So anyway, hopefully that shows Casco what we're doing, shows you what we're doing, and Eugene. As far as the RC6 goes, we're getting ready to tear it down and load up that 8-inch, 5/8-inch wall pipe. You'll see that in a couple days. We're making the Giant's wedding ring. Anyway, that's it for that. Let's walk over to the wood router, and I'll show you what we're doing right there. I'm standing in front of the multi-platform MAD version of our machine, configured as a wood router. Now, we've been selling these machines, I guess, going on a year now, 9 months to a year, something like that. And they've always been able to be configured as wood routers. They do a really, really good job. If you've noticed, I myself have never done a project on these things as a wood router, mainly because we were so backed up on building plasma tables, I didn't want to throw gasoline on the fire and actually increase sales. Can you believe that? Well, anyway, we've got production under control as far as the rotary cutters go and the flat plasmas, so it's time to move into the wood routing market, and we're going to start off with the multi-platform machines with the round rails. In a little while here, maybe in a few months here, we'll probably be bringing out the one with the linear guides on it, and that's going to be a really, truly great wood router with automatic tool change and all. However, since it has linear guides, we're not going to want to use it for plasma. Anyway, let me show you what we've been working on. First thing, a lot of people are using a standard router from that they're picking up from Home Depot, like a DeWalt, a Bosch, or something like that. And that's what you see in the background out there. So the first thing we've already gone ahead and added to the software was the ability to automatically touch the tools off as far as the height of the tool goes. And the reason I want to do that is because I'm going to be doing some rotary cutting projects, and I'm talking really cool, like column statues, to like where a muscle-bound guy's holding up the planet Earth, you know, that kind of stuff. Well, where do you exactly touch off your tool on something when you've carved it all away, right? And the same thing with some of the flat pieces that I'm going to do are very intricate carvings, and there's no more flat left on them to touch, because a lot of machines, you'll have a little wire with a flat plate, and you place it down and you touch off, and that's how you set the height. Well, we want to take it a little bit further, so what we did was we added a very low-cost probe system right here, so that when you change the tools out, you could hit a button and the head will automatically come over, touch off on the probe, and you don't have to worry about setting it for your workpiece. That's the first thing we've done. That is 100% done, already in the software. Now, the next thing we did was we've added an on-off switch that we can control from our controller and the software that will turn the spindle on and off. You could see the cable back there. However, with that kind of spindle, we can't automatically vary the RPM with our controller. We can only turn it on and turn it off. So we're making the move over to the high-speed spindles. Now, there's a couple of spindles out there you can get. There's several companies. One is HSD out of Italy. Makes a very, very good spindle, pretty pricey. Then you have the Chinese spindles, and this happens to be a 4kW air-cooled spindle right here. And it's much, much, much cheaper, to the tune of less than $300 for this spindle. It's a 24,000 RPM spindle. And from my research that I've done looking into these spindles, they work extremely well. Most people are saying they got well over 1,000 hours on a spindle. And at $300, you're talking, what, 30 cents an hour to run this spindle? I'm gonna do that. If it dies in 1,000 hours, I'm just going to buy me another $300 spindle, have a brand new spindle. Now, when it comes to the VFD, the variable frequency drive controller that controls the motor, we didn't have any luck at all with the Chinese ones. So we went with a Japanese-made Fuji VFD. Boy, it works really good. So we've already got the software and everything is talking to the spindle, forward, reverse, speed, on, off, everything. In fact, you could see the VFD has been mounted. We've made a new box that you could add to your machine if you've already got the multi-platform machine. So it's already mounted. We've got everything wired all the way back to that orange cable back there, and that's what they have to wire into the spindle itself. Now, what they're waiting on is me. I'm designing the tram mount so that when we mount this on the machine, we can true it, you know, rotate it, you know, so that it's basically everything's laying flat. So as you make your cuts, they're flat on your board. So I hope to get that designed and machined this week if I can. I'm pretty sure I've got it knocked off. And then I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to do some projects. And I don't want to do simple stuff like, oh, a little teeny sign, you know, hey, you know, the Smith family founded 1980, that kind. I want really, really cool stuff. So go ahead and subscribe if you want to see that, because I want to do a ton of this stuff as soon as I get that tram system built for them guys. Now, the only other thing is I shot this video to give you a quick update about the RC6, what we're doing here. And all this should be done by next week, by the way. So you should see videos coming up on the wood routing. The only other thing that's really exciting around here is even though I swore I would never do it, I developed two new tube notchers, and they'll be coming out later. We're working with the patent attorneys because seems like everything we build at JD Squared, somebody here in America will send it to China and have it copied. That's just what these people do. In fact, I don't know if we're getting beat by anything. I know we're competing with 42 companies, at least when we quit counting, that copied our benders. We do have new benders coming out here in a couple months. I swore I'd never do that again too, but we've already built one. It worked really, really good. It'll mount horizontal or vertical. It's really cool, but it's just not quite there yet. Something in my mind's telling me that it could be better, so I'm holding off. However, the two new tube notchers I designed are just killer. So you'll see a video on those in a couple weeks. I think they're the best notchers in the world. Very, very versatile, and they will be not replacing the Notchmaster or the Beast, but you're gonna want to buy this one. They're not very much more expensive than a Notchmaster, and they got loads of functionality. For instance, you can make notches in the middle of a bend. It doesn't matter angle, anything like that. So go ahead and subscribe if you want to see that. I'll get that done here this week, and you'll see them come out. Other than that, that's about it. If you've got any questions, do like what Eugene and Casco, just send me an email, and I can go out and shoot a quick video and try to answer your question. Thanks a bunch for watching. Hope you have a great day. I'm going to go ahead and set up for that 8-inch pipe. Goodbye.